All right. Hi, everybody, and welcome to the fourth HICO webinar. I present you Harry Jan, who will present you today an introduction to Ensemble simulation and data assimilation in the context of HPSC.
One moment, make this smaller. Okay, yeah, good morning, everybody. Thanks, Nathalie, for the introduction, and thanks, everybody, for attending this webinar. I have still my this, I would like to move. Yeah, okay, now we can continue. So, yeah. So why this does not work now? Yeah, okay, sorry. Yeah, so this webinar will give a focus on simulation science with a focus on terrestrial systems. So there will be some general parts, but I will often refer again to terrestrial systems. And so massive parallelization and high performance computing was a big step for simulation science. This was associated then with the move towards multiphysics simulations. In our area of research, this is, for example, a combination of atmospheric simulations, land surface simulations, subsurface simulations, which have processes that act on very different time scales. And these developments of massive parallelization also made possible ensemble simulations and certainly quantifications, because from the 80s, 90s onwards, it became clear that uncertainty is a very important issue for the prediction with terrestrial system models. And also later than model data fusion methods increasingly were based on ensemble-based approaches. So in the 70s and the 80s, there was a general focus to find the single best solution to the model data fusion problem. And this changed in the 90s towards the search for a whole spectrum of solutions for the model data fusion methods. So I will give here in this webinar a short introduction to the most common model data fusion methods. So it will be all quite fast. I pay some more attention to the Ensemble Kammel filter methods. In a slide of 4 or 5, I will introduce variational data assimilation. Another 4 or 5 slides on particle filter and also on smoother methods. I think there will not be time for Markov chain Monte Carlo. And at the end, there will also be some outlook, and I will say something on maybe the potential of deep learning methods in this context. So in general, the whole model data fusion methods for high performance computing will gain importance. We have new data types available and an increasing amount of measured data. So we specifically here in Jülich are focused on modeling the terrestrial system, and this is the terrestrial system that goes then from the deeper subsurface via the land surface to the atmosphere, and we have integrated simulation models for this. You see here a sketch from the processes, the different processes that we model, and this is to give you an idea about the equations that are solved with a model that solves this this fully coupled problem. So we see here for the two equations below, solution of subsurface flow. So in the unsaturated zone and in the groundwater, we have here the equation for overland flow. We have the equation for the exchange of water in this case between the land and the atmosphere. And we have here some of the equations for flow in the atmosphere. So altogether, we have for the atmosphere a series of coupled partial differential equations, a very nonlinear. Also, the infiltrating process in the subsurface is a very nonlinear partial differential equation, and the same for the overland flow. And so this whole system is then very complex, very nonlinear. The time scales are very different. So we have fast time scales in the atmosphere, but very slow time scales in the groundwater. So it makes this a very challenging problem to solve. And we have also human intervention in the system, like, for example, the pumping of groundwater. So in Jülich, we use then the TSMP model for this. We have a PARFLOW, which is a model to solve processes in the subsurface, the soil and aquifer, flow equations there. And also the generation of overland flow is handled by PARFLOW. We have then CLM for the land surface modeling. So CLM handles the radiative balance of the land surface, calculates exchanges of water, energy, and carbon between the land and the atmosphere. And then we have the COSMO model, which is for atmospheric weather prediction. COSMO is developed by the German Weather Service, CLM by NCAR, and PARFLOW is a development which is done in Jülich and Bonn, and also by the Colorado School of Mines. On the left, you see how these different models are coupled. And one can use also, for example, only PARFLOW and CLM, or the complete system, or also only COSMO and CLM, so only atmosphere and land surface. So then we come to the next step. In this broad introduction I give here as a motivation why this is important. So we have now these multi-physics models at high resolution in space and in time, very nonlinear. And then, of course, we are faced with important uncertainties. So this concerns also the model itself and the equations, because we are still simplifying, of course, processes. For example, the Richards equation, which is more derived for smaller scales, but is applied now here at large scales and land surface models. For example, also the soil respiration, if we're talking about the carbon cycle, because the decay of the different carbon components, so the more resistant carbon components and less resistant carbon components, is handled by simple exponential functions, and for example, four different boxes that handle this decay. We have many parameters that we need as input for these models. For example, for the subsurface soil and aquifer hydraulic parameters, and we have, for example, also ecosystem parameters. If we use, for example, only the land surface and the subsurface components, if we leave the atmosphere away, then we are faced with important input uncertainties like precipitation and shortwave radiation. Initial conditions and the uncertainty of initial conditions is always an issue. For example, soil moisture content. And if we are interested in simulations at the larger timescales, at the climate timescales, also carbon pools. So this is an example then of the uncertainty we face. This is how we believe that subsurface could look like. This is the hydraulic connectivity for an aquifer. We see here it's an area of 5 kilometers, and we can encounter in reality this kind of heterogeneity in such a small area. So we see hydraulic connectivities which in some regions are 3 orders of magnitude larger than in other regions. We see complicated patterns. And typically, one has for the subsurface limited information. So we have only at, for example, these three locations, information on hydraulic connectivity. So we are facing large uncertainties, and the same holds also for example, inputs to a land surface subsurface model. So if we are talking about precipitation, we see here for an area in southwestern Germany, reconstructed precipitation in 2 months, on the left, July 2007, on the right, November 2007. And the spatial variability is large, as you see. So it can be 5 times larger in some areas, typically the hilly areas here, like this is the Black Forest. 5 times larger than other areas, like, for example, here. And if we would look to instant points in time, we have still less smooth and more variable patterns. So this is all very heterogeneous and complicated. So so there's the motivation. Now we have these complicated models, we have a lot of uncertainty, and this uncertainty has an important impact for long-term predictions. For example, if we look to the impact of climate change on the future development of terrestrial carbon pools, it's important because the amount of carbon that is stored on the land and in the shallow subsurface plays an important role. Is the land acting as a carbon source or sink? This will also influence future impact on the carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere. Same holds for the impact of global change on the amount of water which is stored in aquifers. And we have, of course, also the issue of more short and medium term predictions, like the weather predictions or predictions of floods. So the whole uncertainty issue is important here. Therefore, people move towards ensemble model calculations, as I indicated before, because there are many sources of considerable uncertainty, and especially also because our equations are very nonlinear. So we cannot just reconstruct, let's say, mean initial conditions together with mean parameter values and mean forcings, because it does not give us the best estimate of the output variables. So it would not give us the, let's say, mean output variables, because our model is non-linear. And in addition to this, such a single estimate would be of a limited value, because given the uncertainty, the large uncertainty and the limited amount of information, we would have a whole possible spectrum of possible developments towards the near future. Therefore, the ensemble modeling approach is important, and let's say the revolution in the possibilities in computation made it possible that people started doing ensemble modeling. And this is a general development in high performance computing. It's not only in geosciences or terrestrial sciences. So it increases, of course, the requirements for the compute resources and parallelization, because we have to repeat model runs many times. And for example, in our case, we would deal then with two parallelization layers. So the parallelization of the individual model components together with a parallelization, because these coupled models we are running multiple times. And these ensemble runs, therefore, are also done at a lower resolution, at maybe a central model run. There was a development. It's nice to look back to the 70s, where Alan Freeze, in a paper in Water Resources Research in 1975, detected this issue. And until then, people were doing simulations in groundwater with assigning some fixed parameters to certain geological strata or soil horizons, and he started varying these parameters to introduce more heterogeneity. And he saw then that degree of uncertainty associated with hydraulic head predictions, so it's the pressure which is predicted for the subsurface components of the terrestrial system, increases as degree of non-uniformity of the porous medium increases. For large values of let's say parameter uncertainties, it becomes virtually impossible to obtain meaningful hydraulic head predictions. The results of this study throw into question the validity of the hidden assumption that underlies all the deterministic groundwater modeling, namely that it's possible to select a single value for each flow parameter in a homogeneous but non-uniform medium that is somehow representative and hence define an equivalent uniform porous medium. So that was a very negative message then in the paper, but it turned out later that people argued that there are correlations in these spatial patterns. So it's not that we are dealing with a complete chaos in the subsurface. This message in this paper was too negative. It was a very influential paper, but people found that there are ways out of this dilemma. So this resulted in the popularization of ensemble methods in hydrology in the 90s, and also the European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecast, started then in 1992 with ensemble weather predictions to capture the uncertainty. So this was a big step in weather prediction at the short and medium time scale. And so the use of ensemble methods was further increased then in the 21st century. Then we come to the point that we have now our model, we have the uncertainty, we do therefore ensemble simulations, and so we're happy that we also have data. And so especially in atmospheric sciences, there's a long tradition of measurement networks. Traditional networks are synoptic stations on the land, buoys on the sea, also vertical soundings that measure atmospheric parameters in a vertical profile with help of balloons. These balloons are a few times a day sent into the air, but it happens nearly exclusively over the land. So these this gives also a lot of information, and this later in the 20th century was extended further with commercial aircraft, so that also in the higher atmosphere above the oceans information is captured, and also because of a large number of meteorological satellites that's launched. So these data are used in data assimilation methods, where these data are combined with model predictions to improve predictions, to combine these data in an optimal way with the prediction. So at the moment, there are like 8 million of data that per time step are assimilated in these atmospheric models. For the subsurface and the land surface, the situation is more complicated. There are some traditional networks that are available, like groundwater wells and river discharge data. There are long time series, but often the data are spread over many institutions because hydrology was and is not a global science, but was more focused, for example, on the catchment scale. So for the future, it would be important to get these data also together in common databases. More recently, there are also networks established to measure soil moisture and land surface fluxes of water, energy, and carbon between the land and the atmosphere, ecological infrastructure. But this is operating only a few decades, and we are now in a process of extending this. But let's say that there are no long time series on soil moisture and land surface fluxes available at the continental or the global scale. And also with respect to the land surface and the subsurface, there's an increasing amount of satellite products which is available, like for example SMOS and SMAP for soil moisture, or for example GRACE for the total water storage. So these data can help now to reduce uncertainty. They give information on the states, they give information on also indirectly parameters, so properties for example of the subsurface or properties of the vegetation. Those data are more valuable if they give information over larger spatial and temporal scales. So if you, for example, have a local soil moisture measurement with a TDR device, this unfortunately only gives information on a small area. So if you measure soil moisture a few meters apart, then the value can again be very different. But other data give information on larger spatial scales, like for example, a measurement of a groundwater level. Data have then also important limitations. The information is incomplete, it's not everywhere, it's not always. So even if we have satellite information, this satellite only has a visiting time, for example, each few days each few weeks. The issues of scale mismatch, we have a model grid which has typically a different resolution as the measurement. And of course, we have random measurement errors and unfortunately also systematic errors. And then there can be a complicated relation between what is measured and reality. For example, the small satellite measured brightness temperature, and we still need another model to transfer brightness temperature into soil moisture content. So it's complicated. So we are now at the point that We are at the point that we combine then model predictions and data, and we can go back to Bayes' law to understand how this is done. So we have on the left hand side the posterior probability density function. So this is the probability density function of, let's say, X model states given the measurements I. And this is equal to a prior probability density function, so a probability density function of X. So these are the model states times the likelihood. So that's the probability of the observed data for various values of the unknown states. So the posterior probability density function is equal to the prior times the likelihood. It's divided by the evidence. We now do not have to worry so much about the evidence. So with the evidence, we make sure that the posterior probability density function, the integral over the probability density function, is equal to one. But we can leave it out here. So we focused on the prior and the likelihood. So then we have different approximations to solve this Bayes' law. And I divided it here in four groups. We can make a Gaussian approximation, or we do not do this. And we can make a sequential approach, which would mean that we process the measurement data sequentially. So we have measurement at a certain time point. They are combined with the model predictions. The model predictions are updated, and we move to the next time point where we again have measurements. So that would be a sequential approach. This is based on a Markov assumption, and sequential approaches are all type of Kalman filters. If we make a Gaussian approximation, and if we do not make a Gaussian approximation, particle filters. We can also follow a batch approach, which means that we consider measurement data over different time steps. So this can be a longer period. So we consider, for example, measurements over a period of a few years. And this is typically done in groundwater flow modeling. It can also be a shorter period, for example, of only 12 hours. This is, for example, done in atmospheric data assimilation. So measurements over the last 12 hours are assimilated using variational data assimilation. But it's still a batch approach because we have measurements at different time points. So general problem with Bayes' law is that it cannot be solved for high dimensional problems. Therefore, these approximations are made. The Gaussian approximation, I said, is the basis for variational data assimilation or least squares inverse problems. And this gives rise then to, for example, this equation. So we have here now an objective function that we want to minimize, and there are two parts here. So I first go to the right. So here we have the mismatch of the mismatch between data and model predictions. So here we have the data stored in this vector, and in this vector X we have our model states. We have this measurement operator H that maps between the observation space and the model space in order to compare the measurements. And these are weighted by the measurement error covariance matrix. So we can also, for example, consider that some measurements have larger measurement errors than others. So this is the misfit, but we take also into account prior information. So according to Bayes' law, because our posterior probability density function is the prior times the likelihood. So this is, let's say, the likelihood that we have here, and here we have the prior. So we have some initial guess, which is stored in the vector XB, and we do not want to deviate too much from this vector XB, so in the updated states X. And also here, these are weighted with the model error covariance matrix. So if we have large model errors, we would the penalty is smaller to deviate from the our prior guesses. If we have a low model error, the penalization is larger if we deviate more from the initial guess. So we see these two contributions, and then typically We would use here in the simulation period, for example, all these measurements at the same time at the different time steps to update our model trajectory. So we minimize then this objective function. For example, in groundwater hydrology, this is typically done with respect to parameters, because it's believed that in groundwater hydrology, the parameters are the dominant source of uncertainty. In atmospheric sciences, this is, for example, done with respect to initial conditions, because there we have the largest source of uncertainty, and because of our very non-linear model has small uncertainties or errors in initial conditions can grow fast and create very fast, very different atmospheric conditions. So we have a resulting optimized model trajectory, which is according to the model physics. And from this trajectory, we, for example, then adapt the initial conditions so that this model trajectory is as close as possible to the measurements. The gradient of this objective function is calculated when with the adjoint state of a tangent linear model, and this adjoint state model is backwards integrated in time. If we have the gradient of this objective function, we minimize also this objective function along the gradient, or in fact not exactly along the gradient. We could use steepest descent algorithms, but it is normally better to search not directly along the gradient, but for example use Conjugate gradient methods or quasi Newton methods to minimize then this objective function on the basis of the gradient. So this is done using iterative methods. So we have here then outer iterations. So this gradient of the objective function is calculated multiple times. We cannot reach, let's say, the minimum in one step, so it's repeated multiple times. And then we have also these inner iterations, because we also optimize on the basis of the gradient that we found. So in general, this requires many model evaluations. So with the variational data assimilation, we solve, in fact, only we have only one model run, but still we need to repeat many times the model evaluations because of this iterative procedure. So there are some aspects of this variational data assimilation. I already said that we have the Gaussian approximation, so we can see this as a limitation. A nice thing is that we fit a whole model trajectory at once because of a beta batch approach. And in general, the adjoint of the linear tangent model has to be modified if we change our model. So this is intensive work, and it's also code intrusive. So this is certainly a disadvantage of variational data assimilation. Parallelization in the form of domain decomposition, not composition, decomposition, we can do both for forward and joint model runs in a very similar way. And also these inner loops can be parallelized. So it's a quite straightforward parallelization of the approach. Problem is the uncertainty characterization here, because this we do with the Jacobian matrix and we neglect second order terms. So we have in fact the linearization of the Hessian. I'm not sure where you can still hear me. I push the button here. Okay. Therefore, there's also a newer development that the variational data assimilation now is also done in an ensemble approach. So an ensemble for the VAR, for better uncertainty characterization. So that's a, let's say, new development. It depends if the compute needs a higher for ensemble Kalman filter. I made a comparison for a groundwater flow problem with an own implementation I made for variational data assimilation compared to ensemble Kalman filter, so sequential data assimilation. I found there that the compute needs were larger for variational data assimilation, but I would not directly say that this is the case for let's say each problem. In any case, I think if you move to ensemble variational data assimilation, then variational data assimilation is in any case more expensive than, for example, ensemble Kalman filter. Yeah, so this is one approach. Another approach is the Kalman filter. In this case, we make an additional important assumption, and that's a Markovian assumption. So we say that the solution at the time step t plus one depends only on time step t. It's a logical assumption if we do model calculations. No, because in model calculations, if we make a solution with our numerical model for the next time step t plus one, it's all based on the conditions we had before for time step t. Another important assumption is now also that the measurement errors are independent in time. So this can be maybe often the case, but for example, if we have satellite information, we could expect that measurement errors show, for example, correlations over time. So this assumption is also made. And because we make this assumption, we can then process the measurement data sequentially in time. And Bayes law is now applied recursively. So it means that we apply Bayes law for a set of data at a time point T. We move to the next time point. We incorporate again new data, so the time point T plus one. We again merge data and model predictions, and we move to time point T plus two. We incorporate new measured data, and so on. We make again a Gaussian approximation, and you see that then for our posterior probability density function for the states x given the measurements I, we have here an expression that looks very similar to the one we had before for the variational data assimilation. If we talk now about an ensemble Kalman filter, it means that we have a Monte Carlo variant of this classical Kalman filter, and this is also then robust for nonlinear dynamics to a certain degree. So the thing with the ensemble Kalman filter, and this would also be for the particle filter the case, is that we now move into time. So we are for example, the time point t0. We have data here, and these data are used to update the states for the model states for the time point t0. We move to the next time point t1, and we use the measurements now to update model states at t1. We move to the time point t2, and again we update the states, and so on. So the data are processed sequentially. We can also visualize this here with this scheme taken from the paper from Dennis McLaughlin and Advances in Water Resources. So we have here our model predictions. We have different predictions now. This is our Monte Carlo approach. It characterizes our uncertainty. We move to a next time point. Our uncertainty typically increases because of our propagating nonlinear model equations. And we have now some measurement, and therefore our model states are pooled towards these measurements, and we can make the predictions for the next time step. We have our equations for the ensemble Kalman filter here. So the upper equation is the prediction equation. So in fact, what I say here is just that we're doing our model predictions. So we have our states at t minus one, and we make the predictions for this time step t. Nothing else. And we have parameters and model forcings, which are used as input here. The special thing is here now that we do this in an ensemble approach. So we solve this equation not one time, but for example, 100 times. That's one equation. Then we have our measurement equation. So this measurement equation links our measurements, which are stored in this vector I, to the model states. And so we have an operator here that links these measurements to the model states. Because, for example, we have a few measurements and they are linked to certain model states, so certain Gret cells. So we want to make the comparison of the measurement and the model states at those Gret cells. And there's also some measurement error, which we have in this vector. Where's the mouse? Yeah, here in the vector V. Then we have here an update equation. So we have our model states here. They are updated. So we have our prediction for each ensemble member, and we have our correction, so the updated prediction, and here we have the correction term. So we see that the correction is based on the differences between measurements and modeled values at the measurement locations. This is here. And this matrix K defines then how this information, so these mismatches, are interpolated in space. And this interpolation is based then on the relative magnitude of let's say the uncertainty that we have in our model simulation and the uncertainty that we have in our measurements. You can see this in this equation here. So this matrix C captures the model error covariances, and this matrix R captures the measurement error covariances. So we have here, in fact, you can say, for a scalar problem, we would have the variance of the model prediction divided by the variance of the model prediction plus the variance of the measurements. It still sounds. I touched again the bottom. So this K goes towards zero, for example, if we would have very large measurement errors and small uncertainty in the model predictions. It moves to one if we have very uncertain model predictions and very small measurement errors. But of course, these matrices handle also, importantly, the interpolation of these innovations. So the interpolation of these corrections. And this interpolation is done then with help of model physics, because the model physics is captured in this covariance matrix C. Some examples then, and I think I have to go a bit. I have to skip some things later. So for our prediction equation, I said that we do this prediction equation many times, for example, 100 times. So we have different inputs. So with these different inputs, we get this uncertainty. We do the ensemble simulations. So for example, for our soil parameters, we can have stochastic realizations. So these are spatial variable fields of inputs. They can, for example, be generated with geostatistical methods. So we have, for example, here a spatial variable field of saturated hydraulic conductivity, and here of the Van Genuchten parameters alpha and n. So these three fields would be inputs, and we would have then not one set of those fields, but 100 different sets. So that's one example of the uncertain input, but we can make many of our model inputs uncertain and do these ensemble runs. Then the measurement equation is illustrated here. We have, for example, a small model grid with 9 grid cells, and we have at 3 of the grid cells, we have measurements, and you see here how we link then these 3 measurements, which are stored in this vector here, with the 9 model states, in this case, soil moisture values. So with this matrix H, we link now the measurements to the model states so that they can be compared. This is a very simple case. This is slightly more complicated. We can have also, for example, a measurement, a remote sensing measurement that covers 9 grid cells. So we would now compare one measurement, one remote sensing measurement, which is given here, with all the 9 model states. So therefore, we would give weights 1/9 to each of the 9 model states, and we would like that our measured value is equal to 1/9 plus the first model state plus 1/9 plus the second model state, and so on. So we can handle with this H matrix also different support scales, so difference in scale of the measurements and the model calculations. Then we go to the last equation in the ensemble Kalman filter. This illustrates how we calculate the covariance matrix. For a very small model grid of only 4 grid cells, we have then a covariance model covariance matrix of 4 times 4 with covariances. And for example, the covariance between the first grid cell and the fourth grid cell can be calculated in the way that is shown here. We have, for example, a first model run where the soil moisture for the first grid cell has this value and for the grid cell 4 has this value. We have a second model run with these values and so on until, for example, model run 200. So this allows us then to calculate the covariance from the ensemble. And then, in summary, each ensemble member is updated with this equation. This was our forecast. These were the differences between measurements and model simulations. And here enters the Kalman gain, the weighting of these differences and the spread of the information in space. The important advantage compared to the classical ensemble Kalman filter and the extended Kalman filter is now that these covariances only need to be calculated between the measurement points and the states. This is this product here, CH and HCH. This means that in the matrix which needs to be inverted has the size of the number of measurement points times the number of measurement points. And often this is much smaller than the number of model states. So we do not have to invert a very big matrix anymore. This can still be the case. And then we have other methods which have been developed to handle this. So what we get now is that we update a single model run based on the statistics of the rest of the ensemble. So it means that we have an intensive communication between processors. If we have normal ensemble model runs, these runs can be quite independent. But now there's a continuous communication because the updates of the individual ensemble runs depends on all the other runs. So we can visualize this as a number of points in a high dimensional space. If we have, for example, a model with a million unknown states, one model run is a point in this one dimensional space. And we have, for example, 99 of other points also in this 1 million dimensional space. So the 100 points, and of course they cannot sample very well this very high dimensional space because we have only 100 model runs that characterize this very high dimensional space. Now we have also some measurements that do not measure all states, but only a few of them. And this cloud of points in this high dimensional space is now attracted towards these few measurements. And the degree of attraction depends now also on the internal distances between these different points in the high dimensional space. So if these points are very close together, which means little model uncertainty, they will be less affected by measurements, and they will be less the trajectory in time of these points in the high dimensional space will be less affected by the measurements. If model predictions are very uncertain, this large cloud of points will be deviated much stronger towards the measurements. So this is happening in this updating step. And this explains that there's a lot of communication going on. So therefore, it's also challenging from the HPC point of view. And the problem is that not all ensemble members will calculate it in the same speed, especially for subsurface problems. If you have, for example, an infiltrating front in the soil, it depends on the soil properties how fast a numerical solution can be calculated. If we have a very dry soil and there is a sudden infiltration of water, it's from the numerical point of view very intensive, and the calculations take longer. If we have another soil which is less sandy and therefore wetter, the problem is less non-linear. So we can get the case that some ensemble member needs 100 times more compute time than another ensemble member. So we get there for load imbalancing. And some processors after a short time already are not working anymore. And we would like that those processors would collaborate now to solve the compute problem for the other ensemble members. So this is also an issue for future research to improve the efficiency in these cases. I think I'm talking already a long time, and it's that I do not go now into detail on the parameter estimation. We can also do ensemble common filter with parameter estimation, for example, with an augmented state vector approach. And the ensemble common filter has important limitations, like, for example, that we assume Gaussianity. We have a low rank approximation of the model covariance matrix, for example, because we have 1 million unknowns and we have only 100 ensemble members. And this is this low rank approximation. The result is that we get also correlations, which are calculated with the model error covariance matrix between some points and other points which are far away. And we can get quite significant correlations of, for example, 0.2. And in reality, maybe the correlation should be zero. So these are called spurious correlations, which should not exist, but we get them because we have a relatively small ensemble. And these spurious correlations can cause all kinds of artifacts. And many modifications of the classical ensemble Kalman filter are focused on resolving this issue. So there are localization methods which are standard used, for example, in atmospheric data simulation now, and also in subsurface applications. Inflation is standard used in atmospheric data simulation. And also transformation and Kalman gain regularization are other issues to make the ensemble Kalman filter work better, but I cannot go into details here. So we skip these slides here. And I think it's good to say also shortly something about smoother methods like the ensemble Kalman smoother. This is another method to fuse model predictions and measurement data. In this case, the measurement at the time step are used to update information like states, maybe also parameters for all past time step. So there's an example shown here. So we go, we process again information in time. And for example, when we reach the time point T5 with our model predictions, we use the measurements at T5 not only to update the states at this time point, but also the states in the past. So for the time steps 4, 3, 2, 1, and 0, for example. But the difference with variational data simulation is that this is also done using an ensemble approach and not with the variational method. So the ensemble Kalman smoother is therefore an extension of the ensemble Kalman filter. So states can be updated with past, present, and future measurements. So this sounds a bit strange that we update states with future measurements, but this would, for example, mean that our states at the time point T2 here are also updated with measurements at the time point T5. This can, of course, only been done later in time. This can still be useful, for example, if we want to make an optimal reconstruction of the past. For example, in atmospheric reanalysis, we could use for our reanalysis at this time point also future measurements if these measurements still have some relation with this time point T2. The advantage is here that we do not need additional forward model runs. So we have with the ensemble Kalman smoother not much more compute time as with the ensemble Kalman filter. And we do not have iterations like in the variational data simulation. So this is a nice property. The ensemble Kalman filter is now a first guess solution. And the estimates can be improved further if we assimilate then future observations. For example, if we arrive at the time point T5 here, our estimate at this point would be an ensemble Kármán filter. If we go further in time and we have, for example, measurements at the time point T6, we could use those measurements at the time point T6 to update also our prediction at T5. So then our estimate is a little bit better than our original ensemble Kármán filter method if the measurements at T6 still have some relation with T5, so if there's temporal correlation. So we still improve a bit further. The important disadvantage is that we need to store past ensembles. And if we, for example, think about our fully coupled model simulations, this is very expensive. And so we get really a storage issue here. So one can use the storage requirements, for example, by limiting the updates to selected time points of interest and maybe also selected points in space. It can, for example, be that we are at this time point in the past especially interested in, let's say, what was the river discharge at that time point. And we want to have a reconstruction which is as good as possible of that river discharge, and it's just one point along the river. So we would not need to store then so much information. And we can also limit the updates to a time horizon where we expect a significant correlation. We would, of course, not update for this time point T5 with measurement at, for example, time point T1000, which is far in the future. So this can reduce the storage requirements, but still, yeah, the storage is a main issue with the ensemble Kármán smoother if we use distributed models with many unknown states. Then, the last method I would like to discuss shortly then is the particle filter. We can also derive the particle filter also from Bayes' law. So you see here an equation which is very similar to Bayes' law. So we have on the left-hand side again our posterior probability density function. It's written in a slightly different way. We have here our states for the time point 1 till t, conditioned on the measurement for the this same period, and so it is our posterior probability density function, the same one as we saw before, which is equal to the prior, and the prior is now decomposed in two terms. We have our earlier model prediction, let's say for the time point t minus 1, which was already conditioned on the measurements until then, so this we have here, and then we have a new, let's say forward model run. So that we go from the states at t minus 1 to the states at t. But this is done then in an ensemble approach. So we go from a PDF at the time point x at the time point t minus 1 to the time point at t. So this altogether gives our prior probability density function at the time point t. And here we have our likelihood, and our likelihood measures again the mismatch between measurements and model states. So you see them here. And these are again weighted with the measurement errors. So these are likelihoods. So the thing now with a particle filter is that we estimate this posterior probability density function with a series of model runs, particles. So this is still very similar to the ensemble Kármán filter. The main difference is now that the ensemble Kármán filter pools individual model runs towards the observations with this term that we have seen. That we have seen here. So this is a very strong term and makes the ensemble Kármán filter efficient. And with the particle filter, this is not done. So in fact, the model runs in theory are not modified, and the particle filter assigns different weights to the individual model runs based on the fit to the data. So if we have a large misfit here, a large difference between measurement and model simulations, we get small weights. If a model simulation is closer to the measurements, we get a larger weight. But that, let's say, is the main thing which is happening. It's not completely true. We will see this in the next slide. But yeah, basically, the different model simulations get different weights. So this is then inefficient because most particles have very low weights and a few particles receive large weights. In general, we need therefore a larger ensemble. So we need more compute resources. The weight for the different particles dependent on the prior weights and the likelihoods. We see this, for example, the sequential importance sampling. We have here our weights, which are the prior weights given this function. And this is then at the end, we can take, for example, the likelihoods for this. So let's say that we get a weighting of the different particles according to the likelihood, so how well they reproduce the measurements. Then typically we need to do a resampling because normally we have a few particles have a very high weights and the other particles have a zero weight. So we have only a few model runs left which are relevant for our problem. But we would like to have a larger ensemble to sample better the probability density functions. Therefore, we need to replace the particles which have very low weights and resample the most successful particles. So this is done in the particle filter. But yeah, we cannot just copy the most successful particles because we have identical model runs. So we need to add some small perturbation to those new particles. And normally the procedures that I use for this are, let's say, heuristically. So it's also trial and error. And I have to say that there are also new resampling strategies, formulated other resampling strategies. For sure, there are also better resampling strategies that make the particle filter more efficient. But this sequential importance resampling is, let's say, quite a standard particle filter. So in this figure, you see how this works. We have, for example, a model run at time point t minus one. We have here observations available, which is characterized by this function, and we have our different model runs which are fit better the data or not. So if the particles are here, they would fit very well, but you see that some are have very low scores. So those model runs like this model run here and this model run here would get a weight equal to zero then afterwards, and they are eliminated because they have such a small weights. And other particles continue, and we see that, for example, these very successful particles here, they are duplicated. For example, this particle, we make three new particles that duplicated. Those particles, we have to add a small perturbation. Because otherwise we would have identical model runs, and this is then illustrated here that we add this perturbation and we have these new model runs here. So this is what's done in the sequential importance resampling particle filter. The big advantage of particle filter is that in theory it's flexible for any kind of statistical distribution, so for non-multi-Gaussian distribution, and in our non-linear models we typically have these non-Gaussian and often very non-Gaussian distributions. It's also, in any case, a good approach if you have problems with a few unknown states and parameters, like also the Markov chain Monte Carlo method. But the method is still not efficient enough for high dimensional problems. Some people argue that the particle filter has reached the point that it's now efficient also for high dimensional problems. So concerning high performance computing requirements, we could in general say that the compute needs are larger because we need a larger ensemble, and maybe the load and balancing issues would also be larger because we have a larger number of parallel model runs. So the probability is higher that one of these model runs has very extreme settings which is more difficult than to solve numerically. And also the sampling is in general less efficient, so we have a higher probability to get strange combinations of parameters with more problems to solve that model numerically. There are some new particle filters that claim to be efficient for high dimensional problems. The equivalent weight particle filter was introduced by Van Leeuwen in 2010. Recent studies in his group, however, also showed that this equivalent weight particle filter still has an issue of underdispersion. It means that it underestimates the ensemble spread. So we get artificially low variants. So that's still a problem. And they proposed now also a new particle filter that should be efficient for high dimensional problems. That's the variational mapping particle filter. This paper is an archive on the internet and submitted to PNAS. So these are data approaches used in different fields then. I see that I'm talking already a little bit more than 1 hour. I would also like to show something about our work in a few slides, as just a small summary, on work ongoing with the TERS-MP model, so the coupled model from the subsurface via the land surface to the atmosphere. This model has been coupled to a parallel data assimilation framework, which was developed at the Alfred Wegener Institute. It was coupled. The different models are already running in parallel. So Cosmos, CLM, and Parflow. So we assign then processors for each of these models. So typically there is an initial estimate how many processors are needed by the different models. So for example, Cosmos and Parflow need more processors and CLM less. And in addition, there's an additional parallelization layer where the data assimilation is also done. The data assimilation is fully integrated. So it minimized input output, so everything can go over memory, even for problems where we have, for example, up to 10 to the power 8 unknowns. There's a good scalability, and you can see this in the graphs below. For example, we see here that for more than 30,000 processors, we have still parallel efficiencies larger than 0.8. Have to say, this is also for idealized settings. These are settings with an heterogeneous ensemble, but or in input-output handling, but I have to say not with very heterogeneous parameters. So the issues with load imbalancing, that some model runs run much faster than others, this is not accounted for here. So this is still an important challenge, which we also address in our EU project ECHO in the second phase. So different data assimilation algorithms has been activated, and different data types can be assimilated. So we are especially interested also in coupled data assimilation. Very short again, this means we assimilate data types from different terrestrial compartments. For example, we have measurements from the subsurface, so moisture, groundwater levels. We have measurements from the land surface, for example, land surface temperature, leaf area index. All those data are assimilated. They update states for those models. So for example, with these measurements, we update the states of the land surface model. With these measurements, we update states of the subsurface model. And by the action of the model equations, you see this here, then we can also update our atmospheric states. So the atmospheric states will also be affected by the assimilation of these data because we have a coupled model. And next step will be then that we also do fully coupled data assimilation. It means then that we can also use states, for example, soil moisture, not to update only subsurface states, but for example, also update land surface states. So we would use soil moisture measurements to update subsurface states, but for example, also vegetation states, because vegetation states are also correlated with soil moisture. To some degree, this will be possible, and this is still subject of investigation. A fully coupled data assimilation is also an important subject of investigation for atmosphere-ocean problems. So here's an example. I show two examples. One example is for assimilation of soil moisture. This is in a catchment. This is the Ruhr catchment, located in Germany, close to the borders with Belgium and Netherlands. You see here runs with the community land model alone, CLM alone, taken off the TSMP model, and here CLM plus power flow, so subsurface plus land service. You see that soil moisture patterns are more realistic if we have the land service subsurface model. This is our soil moisture distribution without data assimilation. And this is when we incorporate soil moisture measurement from a network of cosmic ray probes. The advantage of cosmic ray probes is that they measure soil moisture over a large area with a diameter of, let's say, 400 meters. So these kind of measurements show a stronger correlation in space than, let's say, very local soil moisture measurements by TDR. So you see a strong update, and below you see also how this affects then the land surface fluxes. In this case, it increases the sensible heat fluxes and it decreases the latent heat fluxes in the northern part of the catchment. This is shown here. The southern part of the catchment is not affected because in both simulations there is still quite a lot of soil moisture. So it does not affect so much the partitioning between sensible and latent heat flux. In this figure you see that with data assimilation, our error goes down. Although there are only 9 of these cosmic ray probes in the catchments, our errors go down. The root mean square error from 9 volume percent soil moisture towards 5 volume percent. And I have to say that this is an evaluation at independent measurement locations. So these locations here in this figure were not included in the assimilation. Go to the second example. So this should also illustrate a bit the complications we face in land surface data assimilation. So things I talked about before, we have then, for example, in a model, and this case is another model, I took this example from a literature. This is work done at the NASA on the assimilation of SMAP data at a global scale. Models calculate soil temperature, soil moisture, vegetation. So different variables are calculated or used as input. Then this these data are used to calculate the brightness temperature. So with a radiative transfer model. So this is done here. And this is done to calculate the brightness temperature by the model in order to be able to compare the model with the measurements. Because we have here also measurements from the SMOS radiometer, where brightness temperature is measured. And so we have the measured brightness temperature, and now we have the brightness temperature which is simulated, so but it's indirectly calculated from the model. And these two need to be compared, but this still cannot be done directly because our measurements from the satellites give information over a larger area, not just one model grid, but multiple model grid cells, and also it has a larger weight for the central model grid cell, shown here. So, so therefore, we weight these modeled brightness temperatures and give larger weight to the central grid cell and less to the corner grid cell. Then we can come at the point that we can directly compare patterns from the radiometer with the simulated brightness temperature. And then this can be used then to update soil temperature and especially soil moisture. So we go then again back from brightness temperature to those variables. So you see that this is a complicated procedure. In Jülich, also work is done on this. This is done by Bibi Nas, working also in the context of the ECHO project. See assimilated soil moisture in the land surface model CLM 3.5. used PDAF that I introduced before. So now only the land surface component is used. The model resolution is 3 kilometers. We have available forcing from an atmospheric model at a 6 kilometer resolution. So because we do not include our atmospheric model now, so we need as an, let's say, upper boundary condition as a forcing, the atmospheric conditions. Then we have our soil moisture product, which has a different resolution at 25 kilometers. So the mismatch in the resolutions has to be taken into account. In our test, the test that Bibi made, only 100 grid cells were randomly selected and used in the data simulation. Yeah, we can have a look at the results. So here you see the soil moisture by satellites for different seasons: winter, spring, summer, and autumn. These are open loop simulations, so without data simulation, just model CLM component of the TSMP model, and this is after data simulation. You see now that it's closer to the measurements, but it was then compared with other measurements, so at other locations which were not assimilated, and also with runoff information, and it was found that this assimilation gave some small improvement in the reproduction of soil moisture and runoff. So I come at the last slide. I went quite a lot over time. So as an outlook, I would say that for the future, non-multi-Gaussian data simulation is of high interest. People are working on improved efficiency of particle filter methods and the Markov chain Monte Carlo methods. And yeah, I think that the point will be reached that these methods will become also efficient for high dimensional problems. First a particle filter, and probably later also Markov chain Monte Carlo methods, which I did not talk about today, but that would be, let's say, a solution which is closest to Bayes' law with the less approximations. Coupled data simulation will be an important issue to handle, given the coupled models we have and the multi-physics issues we are dealing with. An important question can also be like whether deep learning methods, whether in future they can outperform formal model data fusion methods. One can argue that at some point in time this can be realized. I mean, an objective of data assimilation and inverse modeling was always to go towards automatic calibration in a time period before the 70s, or maybe in the, no, I have to say, no, I have to say in the 70s and the 80s, then already automatic methods were developed, but still in practice, normally trial and error was done to change model parameters and to fit data instead of automated computer algorithms, which at that time were developed already, but not in broad use. So this is for sure an intention. An issue is that methods like deep learning needs to be physics based, because there's already a lot of information in our forward model. So a series of very nonlinear partial differential equations is solved, and let's say that these forward methods include at the moment these model physics. So the covariances are physics based. This will be important. So one can think, for example, about a problem that we map parameters that we have as input, we calculate the states, and we can learn this mapping procedure from parameters to states for a given problem, present, let's say, the deep learning algorithm, many different inputs and outputs. And it has now been shown that for simple groundwater problems, for example, such an algorithm is able then to reproduce groundwater solutions for arbitrary parameter filters input. The inverse mapping then from states back to parameters is also possible if you have all states available. is if it's a well-defined problem. As soon as you have then only a few states which are measured and you have to map back to the parameters, then you get another problem because you then have not one solution anymore, but you need in fact to calculate a large number of different solutions or different parameter distributions. So you need the probability density function. So that will be more challenging, and I would argue that it's crucial to have really the posterior probability density function, because given our very nonlinear models that we use and these simulations, small deviations of the initial conditions can already give very different predictions. So it's important that we sample correctly our posterior probability density functions for future predictions and to have realistic predictions, for example, for extreme events. So I think, these are two key issues for deep learning in the context, for example, of model data fusion, that's physics-based and that it can characterize this uncertainty correctly. And especially for atmospheric applications, this is very challenging given chaos theory. So if we would train very large numbers of atmospheric simulations where we have initial conditions and we present the solution of the equations after some time steps, it still would probably need enormous time series to be able to do this, given global calculations, given many variables, given the high spatial resolutions and given the nonlinearity. So I think this will be still very challenging. Okay, so thank you for your attention. This was a bit strange because I do not see the publicum speaking. So I hope it was interesting for you. It was for me also a bit difficult because probably in the audience people with very different backgrounds. I hope it was of use for you. Thank you. And let's see how I can open now questions. The possibility for people to ask questions. Thank you. Are there questions? Hello, okay. Nathalie.
Yes, thank you very much, Jan. Because so you have one question. You can find the question, the written question in your dashboard. Can you see them?
Yes, I see Bruno Raffin has a question. Yes, can I click on it? Or?
Yes, you just have to click on question and you can see the question. The question is, could you give us some numbers regarding number of ensemble runs, for instance?
Yeah, so this number of ensemble runs depends also on the typical application. So for atmospheric runs, the ECM WF has 51 ensemble runs at two times in a day, or the American meteorological prediction has four times a day 20 predictions. So in a day they have like 80 or 100 model runs. If we go to, for example, the groundwater applications and people work only with the groundwater model, typically a large ensemble is used. So this is often hundreds, but also going towards 1,000 model runs. For our coupled problems, we are happy if we can also do, for example, 128 ensemble model runs. It's clear that we have issues if we have a smaller ensemble sizes because the quality of our covariances is not so good. It would be good to have still large ensemble sizes. This is for ensemble Kármán filter. For variational data assimilation, there's typically only one solution then. And uncertainty is characterized a posteriori with some linearization. For the particle filter, the number of model runs is typically larger and can be thousands than thousands of model runs. If we would go to Markov chain Monte Carlo, we would have even a larger number of model runs. Yeah, thank you for the question.
Okay, thank you. Are there more questions? No. Okay. Anyway, you can find this webinar again on our website and on our YouTube channel. So don't hesitate to watch it again and to send your question to Harijan directly. That's it, I think, for today. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much, Harijan. It's a very hard exercise and you did very well. So.
Thank you. I'm happy about further questions and feedback. And again, I hope it was of interest for you.
Yes, congratulations, because it's the most successful webinar we had. We had like 67 participants today. So thank you very much to everybody. And see you very soon for the next one, which is the 25th of September.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Rajan. Goodbye.
Bye.